Recording.
Hi, everybody. This is Frank Gladstone here. And we are on our first live stream with a Q&A with Kyle McQueen and Chris Pern. So we're going to go. What I'll do is I'll start with a couple of questions for you guys.
Cool.
Kyle, first of all, I know you're a graduate of Sheridan. And Chris, you're a graduate of Sheridan. And didn't you teach Kyle? Was he a student?
Yeah. Yeah, we're both graduates of Sheridan. What was that, Kyle? 2001, 2000?
Yes, 2002 or 2002.
A long time ago.
How were his grades, Chris?
Kyle was amazing. He was top of the charts.
That's not what he told me.
It's a small weird business. I taught one class. I was teaching character design for 2 years, and just the amount of kind of, I guess, connections, talents, friendships that came out of that experience. It was super valuable. And just, I was kind of a kid teaching kids. It was right at the edge of where the 2D industry was going down and the 3D industry was coming up. So, you know.
Yeah. I wonder about, now I want to go back the other direction. Kyle, you had this guy as a teacher.
Yeah.
He's months older than you. So how was he as a teacher?
Chris was great. I actually think I learned most of what I know from Chris at that time, and I'm not, you know,
come on, you got the job.
It's not just because he's in the room, but I think it was super valuable having. I think maybe because he was so young and he had had experience, so there was an immediate connection there that we could make, you know. And I didn't really come from an art background. I drew a lot, but you know, in high school and stuff, coming into Sheridan, I didn't really have the skill set that a lot of the other students did. So Chris's, just his natural teaching ability was really helpful for me, you know, and you still see that working with him now. It's still there. It's still
Chris,
the same. So it's great.
You still teach on occasion. Yeah. Isn't that true?
A little bit through like just schoolism and some of the online stuff, you know, haven't done much while making this movie because it's been too busy, but I love working with, you know, people who are, you know, just interested about learning the trade, because I think it's such a rich thing to go back and just talk to people about craft. So it's fun, as you know.
Yeah. When I should say a little bit about your background. You were raised by goats, Chris.
Yes.
and Kyle got audience and attendees, SIFA members. Kyle is related to Steve McQueen, which is actually not true. But I thought it would be an interesting thing to
see. I do have a cousin named Steve McQueen. It's just not that Steve McQueen.
It's not that Steve McQueen.
Mesothelioma, isn't that what took him down? Is that
that's his name?
Yeah. Okay.
Too soon.
So I wanted to start by talking. I watched the movie. I thought it was really great, personally. I think it's a little scary, which is not bad. And the parents are terrible. but I wondered about to start. I know that Chris, you worked a lot at Aardman, and I know that Kyle and you talked a lot about the idea of making this look handmade, or almost to the point of not a stop frame. You weren't trying to do a fake stop frame film, but you didn't do a lot of motion blur. You didn't move the camera a whole bunch. Their simple shape design. So I thought you maybe would talk a little bit about that.
I'll start and then I'll throw it over to Kyle. I think, you know, a lot of the principles that were kind of initially embraced were kind of 2D animation principles. So that idea of doing pose to pose animation, really simple, iconic shape language. Early on, we had the idea of colliding two types of filmmaking. So like the sitcom, when they're stuck in the house, that kind of three camera setup, that kind of, you know, whether it's All in the Family or, you know, Cheers, like I really wanted that sort of claustrophobic feeling that was familiar and had that kind of, I guess the word's warmth, like, you know, there's a familiarity to that kind of sitcom language. So that sort of dictated a lot of the camera choices. And then the idea that it was a cat's point of view kind of led us down the line of, you know, the hyper textures and this idea of like a miniature world. And I'll throw it over to Kyle where that kind of picked up.
Yeah. So I think with the cat as well, but also with the kids, you know, it's a story about kids. So we wanted to kind of bring the audience down and see it through their eyes. So having a more visceral, immersive feeling to the world was really important and something that we really aimed for, which sort of led us down the path of that stop motion influence. But I think before we got there, this idea of kids raised on books in this huge old house, you know, there was no internet, or, you know, the kids don't have the internet. So this idea of, you know, turning a page and feeling that paper and the smell of the ink and the smell of those books, and we just wanted to try and capture that visceral feeling.
Speaking of the internet, this is interesting. And one of the things that I thought was really interesting in the movie was this part about the misunderstanding an internet message, not hearing it in the right voice, which is something we've all probably had.
Yep.
And I thought that little plot point there of hearing, I'll take care of you when I'll take care of you, you know, I thought that was really interesting. How did you come up with that?
Well, I think we've all done that in life where you misunderstand something or you do a reply all. Like, I think there's something funny about that kind of misinterpreting technology. I mean, one of the things that I think we had to play with on the comedy front was this idea that these kids had really no awareness of the, or they had awareness, but it was like they were kind of, you know, born into this world and you know, kind of like coming to America or Borat, they just didn't know. And so like that kind of misinterpreting of things as they were learning was really funny. And I think we could really always lean on that for comedy. So we definitely wanted the film to feel like now, like it's happening in a world that we can recognize. So we didn't want to shy away from any of the devices that we could use. So the idea of him misinterpreting a cell phone, you know, voicemail message felt pretty funny to us.
Yeah.
And I brought mom and dad into the movie too, in the middle, which was important.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Those despicable people. I also like the idea of the design that you sort of touch on a little bit, Kyle. You know, you have this kind of Rococo, deep nooks and crannies design in their environment where they're comfortable, or at least where they live. Mm-hmm. And then the design outside is all, it's all angles and, you know, it isn't, it's all kind of sterile and the cars are all hard edged. And I wondered if that was something you really wanted to do.
Yeah, we thought about that a lot, and there was a lot of conversations early on. Sort of one of the key plot points or story points was, you know, these kids are raised in this sort of bubble of that's been stuck in time, you know, and it's this sort of time capsule of this house. And Tim really needs to get out of the house, but is reluctant to, and his siblings really want to get out and explore, but he's the one resisting. And so that idea of keeping the house a little claustrophobic, but sort of feeling like it's a warm, comfortable place, even though, you know, he has terrible parents and it's not the nicest environment to grow up in. But and then being intrigued by the outside world and just that sort of clash of noise and culture and you know, all of that busyness, and with this sort of somber, quiet utopia of this little house that they live in. And I think it was important to just kind of play those two ideas against each other visually, just so we can really feel that change happen.
It's like really a museum almost, doesn't it? Like they're living in a museum.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And it really kind of works. It kind of sets the what they're used to what they are in, which is foreign to them. Mm-hmm. It was pretty interesting.
We really wanted that idea that, like, the kids, instead of coming of age by running away from home, they stay home and trick their parents into leaving. So the juggle was just like the house had to be appealing enough that we, as the audience, would root for the kids to stay there. But still, there's that kind of subtext that, like, they should get out. They kind of need to escape this. That was the line that I think Kyle did a brilliant job at writing between the two worlds.
I think so too. I do. Now, I knew this question would come up, and it's already come up in my list of questions over here.
Ooh.
In the audience. What made you decide not to have the parents, the kids go back to their parents, which, you know, these kind of false ending where the parents get the, oh, we're bad parents. Oh, now we'll be good parents. And then they're bad parents.
Well, you know, like in the, We were iterating off the book, and in the book, it has a very kind of unresolved ending, which is great for a book. But one of the things that we had to sort of rationalize when we were doing our adapting of the story for the screenplay was, you know, a movie needs an ending, and an 85-minute movie, you want to reward the audience with an ending. And I think we love the idea of having multiple endings. I think at one time we had 5 and we narrowed it down to about 3.5. So, you know, the idea of having, we call it the Pixar ending, which is like the kids make their pitch and you think the audience, you think the parents have like listened to them and that they're going to give the kids what they want. Like, I wanted half the audience to be okay with that and half the audience to be really angry at us for making that move and then surprise them when it flips. And I think the second ending is the indie movie ending because we were making a lower budget animated film, so we had to go there. And then the third ending is your sitcom ending where it's like, you know, end of an episode of Roseanne and everybody's fighting each other over the dinner table. So it's like, so we really wanted to lean into the tropes of our references, you know, as we were heading towards the end of the film.
Yeah, that's, I thought that was really interesting. And apparently people writing questions in, you know, and this is another question's come from the group. Drake asks, what was the guiding thing? What was the key? I know there were some words that I was reading about that you had. Let me see if I wrote them down here somewhere. Mischievous, playful, absurd, clever, sentimental. I didn't see scary in that list.
Are you talking about design or story?
I think both.
Both. Okay. Kyle, do you want to lead in design?
Yeah, for design, that's usually the first thing I do is try and, for me, I'll step back. For me, anything visual always comes from story. I think story really drives style. And I think it's really important to kind of have a really tight harmony between those two things and make sure that you're delivering to service story first, not just making things that look good but are impractical. So I try and break the story down as if it had a personality. And those are sort of the personality traits that I come up with. So it's sort of 5 words that help to define the tone of the story, really, and who this person, the story is. And then from there, we can start to attach visual elements to those words and find things that sort of echo those synonyms, from color to design to composition and shape and lighting and all of that stuff. So it's a really kind of quick and easy way to break it down and then start to build it up. But that way you're always servicing story. You're never sort of going off in these, you can always come back and make sure every decision you're making is hitting those marks that you set out in the beginning. That's sort of the process that I go through. But in terms of story, Chris,
I think for me, in terms of like, one of the big kind of early decisions was I didn't want to go into a kind of self-affected place for this movie, because there's some dark themes. Mm-hmm. And the darker themes could have easily gone towards, you know, something that we're familiar with, whether it's, you know, Tim Burton style or, you know, Adam's Family or what have you. And I wanted the film to feel earnest, and I really love the idea of like kind of leaning into optimistic, earnest characters who are deeply flawed. And so one of the things that I think really helped, like in the conversation between Kyle and myself, was just always making sure that the film felt like there was something pretty and funny happening, and that the audience had permission to laugh. And so like the choices of, say, the cat introducing you to the story, that kind of lets you know, puts you on notice what kind of tone it is, and then give you permission to, I think, hopefully it gives the audience permission to laugh through the story. So ultimately all the characters kind of, in the way I pitched it, like out of the gate, was it's Grey Gardens meets Arrested Development for kids. And if you look at that ensemble sort of, you know, structure, everybody has like an earnest want in those classic sitcoms, and they collide with each other. And that was a really just safe starting place for us, if that makes sense.
And you, I know you've talked a little bit about this idea that there's almost a sitcom camera in a lot of this. There's shots that the camera is still or moves close, yeah, up, long shot, you know, that kind of thing, which is from the original way sitcoms were set up in the early days of television. That works really well.
And I think that might give the film that stop motion feeling too, because we are using a lot of kind of reuse, like 3 camera setups in our locations, and we go back to sets, and we tried to shoot as practical as possible. And, you know, every now and then we blow at a wall if we had to to get the shot. But, you know, for the most part, we were trying to treat it like it was a soundstage, and we were shooting it and behind that camera as an audience watching. And it really kind of grounded the story, I think. And then when we do move the camera, when the kids leave the house, even there, we were trying to be practical and looking at, like, you know, whether what kind of camera is it on a dolly, is it on a drone, like you know, is it Steadicam? Like, we were just trying to be really, we're trying to avoid that video game camera if possible. I think that grounds the film, hopefully.
I think ties into your talk about the kind of design you use and the idea of the story, and that was Jane's song. How did that come about? Because that's this kind of optimistic view of all these things at the end of the day. How did the song develop?
Very early on, as we were breaking the characters, we were trying to figure out sort of which each character, you know, was sort of what their arc was going to build off of, the want and the need. And the idea was Jane was a character who had a voice, but nobody listened. And so really early on in the scratch booth, we were experimenting with that idea. So we knew she was going to be a musical character. It was a tricky Polaroid to develop. I'm not a musician, Kyle's a musician, but this is the first time I've ever gone down that road of, you know, how do you build a song from nothing? And we got in really early with Mark Mothersbaugh, who does our composing, and he kind of came up with the do, 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 do. So once we had that kind of, you know, harmony, then we could start to sort of write songs around that. And the notion was always that Jane was working on that song the whole movie. And then at the end, it's going to land as this emotional thing. So that was just like a lot of just, I think, coming up with stuff in the scenes. We were writing the song in the scenes, feeding them to Alessia along the way. And then Alessia was working on the kind of her big song ending. And the one take that is mostly in that last song, she recorded at her home office with a head cold. And it's so sweet and soft. And it was just meant to be a scratch thing, but because it was thrown off without a lot of what's that? Like, she didn't realize that she had like all that pressure on it. It just sort of felt sweet and soft and really, vulnerable. And that vulnerability is the thing that we really wanted in that song at the end. And I think it was an interesting development. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, you can answer the question. I got one from Jay here. What aspects of the film were inspired directly from your life and family? Also, did either of you have a person like Nanny in real life? So it could be your real mom or dad, but maybe it's a goat, Chris.
I kind of had the opposite thing when I was a kid. I grew up on a farm with two brothers, and it wasn't that we were stuck in a house, is that we had a lot of room to roam and no neighbors. So we were kind of, in a lot of ways, kind of like on each other's business in the same way that these Willoughby kids were. And I think, you know, there's something really funny about that, the number three, like, even though there's two twins, it's sort of like, you know, the Barnabys, Jane and Tim. So I think that kind of 1-2-3 structure is something I can really relate to. And I'm the oldest brother, and I was a bit of a dick when I was a kid. So definitely I got a lot of Tim in me. Like to wear the short pants. Like, I think there's some of that is autobiographical. And I always fall downstairs, walk in the walls. I was never good at sports. And so, like, Tim's kind of that way too. So I think there's a lot I relate to with that character. Kyle, I don't know about you.
What about you, Kyle?
Thankfully, no. I had a pretty normal childhood.
Oh, go.
Hairy sound.
Yeah, I just grew up in a small town and, you know, I did all the normal things. And so it was pretty straightforward, thankfully. But the nanny question is interesting. I would say, I mean, my wife is very, very nanny. Like, she has a lot of those traits, just like loving and, you know, warm. And yeah, it's, I wish everybody to have somebody like Nanny in their life, you know, because I think it's so important.
I think so too. Good answers from both of you. So here's a couple of interesting questions. Now, did you build a studio to do this film? I think,
No, there was a studio in Burnaby called Braun, which was, they'd been around for, I think, 4 or 5 years, maybe a little longer. So we were the second movie coming through that pipe. Is that fair to say, Kyle? Is my math right on that?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. We did set up a studio in London, Ontario. It was a satellite from that main studio. So that was where my farm is and hometown, and that's where Kyle is right now. So we had a small team of pre-production there. And for us, it was really useful at the beginning because there's a lot of, you know, talent coming out of Sheridan. So we could tap into some of that, you know, front end drawing, design, story talent in Ontario. And then, you know, most of the machine was in Vancouver. And then there was another satellite studio on Vancouver Island, which was one team of animation.
A lot of Sheridan grads, a lot of Seneca grads and so forth.
Yeah, the whole crew is international. It was kind of amazing. And I don't know when this happened, but Vancouver has become this complete international market. So we had artists from CalArts, from Sheridan, from Ringling, from, you know, all over the world, Gobelins. And, you know, is it Gobelin? How do you pronounce that one? Yeah. Gobelin, yeah. you know, all over the world. So it was pretty amazing crew.
Santosh says, did the direction and cinematography draw from Wes Anderson at all?
A little bit. Yeah, definitely a little bit. I mean, there's definitely a lot of Harold and Maude in there. That's one of my favorite movies, and all the car accidents are a nod to that. You can see there's quite a bit of Shining in there. I don't know if you guys picked it up.
The twins, in a way.
There's Danny. That's Danny. Yeah, that's totally Danny. Kelman wore that on his sleeve, didn't he, Kyle?
Yeah, that was an early choice we made.
I did like the way, first of all, that they would finish each other's language and change sweater.
Well, the sweater swap, yeah. A lot of R&D on that.
Pretty good. The other question I had is, it's a Netflix release, yes?
Yes.
And you said something early on in the discussion, Kyle, is it's a Netflix, it's an indie production, so to speak, which means to me that there was, if a big studio probably wouldn't have wanted to do this movie. That'd be,
yeah.
You know, yeah. Because I would agree with that for sure. Yeah.
Maybe the style, the approach. I mean, even a Roald Dahl film, which this has some, you know, was done by, I guess, Leica at the time. And as an indie, it wasn't really a big picture. How did you work with Netflix? Did they just say go and do, or did they put in notes?
Yeah, we were about a year and a half in when I went into Melissa Cobb's office and pitched, just like the elevator pitch on the film. Mm-hmm. Netflix had just started to, I think, move into this side of the business. They had acquired Klaus, and that was going, and there was a couple of the films that they had started to roll on, but it was pretty early on. Greg Taylor had just started too, and I'd worked with him at DreamWorks, so I had a relationship with both Melissa and Greg. And ultimately, when we showed them the movie, the artwork, they read the book, they got on board, and they were nothing but supportive the entire journey. And we did get notes, and we did get, you know, we had screenings, and we had the usual treadmill, but we had to. I mean, that's sort of, you know, how you work out the material. And I think the legitimacy of what those screenings meant, and sort of like how we got onto that sort of the real production treadmill, like that calcified when Netflix came into the mix. And so they were with us for about, Kyle, is it about 2 years, right? About 2 years of
production. I think we were close to a year just in pre-production, or, you know, early production before.
So the production calendar was about 3 years?
So I was on for about 4.5 years, and I'd say like the first 8 months was mostly script and early development stuff. So
I have three questions left, and then one for me. I love the classic references in the film, but it still felt original. How are you able to use classic references keeping the story original?
I mean, I think the trick is always, you know, finding your shot and you know, how it lands out of the character. So we try to stay in the tone of the voice of the characters or the voice of the scene whenever we would drop in a reference. For example, we have a, you know, Deliverance joke in there where, you know, Tim's talking about being in the bad part of town, and you get the banjo playing in the background. So that's not really a current, I mean, most kids will pick up on that reference, but like, I think the fact that it's subtle, the fact that it supports the tone of the scene, like it reinforces his idea of what it means to be in the bad part of town. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely a cheeky joke, but it's a referential joke, but it didn't feel like the character to step out of himself to get that joke into the movie. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It's just right in that line. So like, the fact that the book was making fun of the tropes of children's literature. We definitely wanted to embrace that as we went into the film. So the film wanted to make fun of the tropes of classic, you know, animated cinema. So we did want to acknowledge the fact that this was a once upon a time story that had those elements, but I never wanted to lean on parody. I didn't want the audience to feel like this was a parody film. So I think in terms of our journey, like all the screenings and stuff, it was just about developing the voices, the characters, and making sure that we were always like sticking to that. So if the joke fought the voice of the characters, the joke came out, or the reference came out, if that makes sense.
Yeah, sure. I have a question here about diverse, well, it's not a question, it's really well, there's a question. Brittany said, love the aspects of diversity in the film. Can you talk about the decision to have that those elements in it, for example, the nanny and the perfect family, which is a mixed race family?
I mean, one of the early themes, and this goes back to when, you know, I was just starting to break the book, was this idea of, you know, this family that's sort of stuck under a legacy, because the book is called The Willoughbys. And so this idea of like this name's like a weight that's sort of holding them down. This is where the Grey Gardens kind of comes in. So I really love the idea that, you know, they've sort of mummified in their own juices in this box, in this house that they have. And then everything that sort of comes into that world, the second that bubble gets popped, I wanted the world outside to feel like the world that we recognize. And ultimately, this was always meant to be a back east sort of landscape. So whether it's Chicago or New York or, you know, Toronto. And what I love about those cities is that they are diverse. And I think like this idea that you can't build a wall to keep ideas out is really what this, one of the big themes of this movie. And I think whether they like it or not, this evolution that they have to go through to sort of figure out what it means to be in a family, and a family is not a name, but a choice. I think this idea that everybody who came into their world was from someplace different felt really important to us. And because our style was so broad and we had so many sort of, you know, such a strong shape language, Kyle and his team were able to kind of really, I think, play with that. Like, you know, it's just, we knew that the baby was from someplace else, but like, we weren't identifying it as being a certain race. It was kind of pink, you know, but there's definitely, it just didn't feel like them. And we really, I love the fact that the icons allowed us to have that conversation without it going into any specific place, if that makes sense.
Yeah. And speaking of that design, I mean, the idea of the factory, mm-hmm. All the Pac-Man gag is terrific. Yeah. But the factory is there, and it's kind of this modern factory in a way, although it's retro, and I bet you must have had fun on that, Kyle. But then the factory creates this dirigible. Mm-hmm. And to me, it was really interesting that the way the factory looked and everything like that, and then to create this kind of retro-y, felt a little bit like their house in a way, and because it was not, you know, sleek and angular, it was squishy, so to speak. I thought that was a pretty interesting design choice. Did that just come like organically, Kyle, or was it a real choice?
For the interior of the factory, I mean, if you look at the exterior, there's a bit of a mirror to the house. So yeah,
and also the
this.
Guy.
Yeah.
He fits the door.
Exactly. In the negative space, you can sort of, he's upside down. Melanoff's shape sits in there too. So it's, you know, we had this little candy shop in between these two big, massive sort of cement pillars. And that we wanted, that was an early choice to have it mirror the Willoughby home. And so Tim could think it's like the perfect place. You know, it's the perfect home to drop this baby. And so in the inside, it was more about a reflection of a man who sort of shut himself away, and that comes from the book, you know. And Melanoff has a lot of sorrow, and we went through a lot of kind of story stuff around Melanoff, but in the end it made sense that we wanted a place that did feel sleek a little bit more than that Willoughby house, but produced these fun, amazing things, you know. And that contrast was really interesting, and we wanted it to be a place where this guy could just run it by himself, you know.
Yeah.
He switches on this wall and he's got it all figured out, because he doesn't want to, he stopped letting people in, you know. So that's where a lot of those choices came from.
I kind of felt that it was a little Wizard of Ozzy.
Yeah.
And then it was Willy Wonka-y.
Well, there's also like Citizen Kane. I mean, there's a whole, like, if you actually watch the screens in there, there's a cartoon that's playing, which is actual stop motion. Foreshadow Films, the Folter Brothers in Vancouver, made this entire film, which we had to cut for time, but then is now nested in the story. And really, it's Melonoff's tragedy. And so he's kind of got this Citizen Kane quality where he had love and lost it and then kind of shut himself into this world where he could, you know, ironically make all of this amazing sweet stuff that children love, but he had no relationship to the children.
Until the baby shows up
and then the baby kind of turns everything on his head. But kind of like his factory, which is very grim on the outside and kind of imposing, once you scratch the surface, there's a lot of sweetness inside. And so Terry Crews was the perfect casting to
I could keep you guys for another 15, 20, 50. There's lots of questions here, but I did want to touch on the voices. First of all, I had Rick Gervais as this terrific, he's almost a Cheshire Cat kind of character, you know. And then you have really great voices. They work great all the way through. Can you give us a encapsulation, number one, of how you chose those voices, and number two, how you designed the characters to work with those voices?
I mean, for me, I always like the idea of casting not the poster, but the characters. And so coming at it from the perspective of like pairing people up, to be really honest, I've worked with some of these actors in the past. And so like some of it was like understanding their voices and really feeling like they would fit into the character. So I'd worked with Terry before. Mm-hmm. I love Will. I'd worked with him on a few projects. And to me, like Last Man was the kind of a perfect model for Tim, you know, somebody who's a little bit, you know, kind of not always the nicest person in the world, but you like him. And I think Will can pull that off. And I think the fact that, you know, he'd worked with Maya so many times before and that their comedy pairing is really always like fun to watch. Like it's looking for those kind of connections. And Martin and Jane being, the idea is like, you know, the parents had to be funny. We always wanted them to be awful, but funny. And if you need that to happen, you have to hire funny people. And I think, you know, Martin and Jane are just absolutely cartoony in their own way, and they found the perfect rhythm, I think, between the two of them, so that there was a little bit of naivety between the parents. So all of those casting choices really came down to the pairings and how those voices work together. And then Kyle, do you want to speak to design, like how that comes?
Yeah, it was a lot of back and forth. I think the characters went through a lot of exploration. So we had Craig Kelman come in, and I mean, he's just a master at what he does. So
and he's crazy too. He's a certifiable lunatic.
We love him.
You put something, a film like this, in the hands of a guy like that, and you get amazing stuff back. And we were spoiled for choice, but really it came down to, you know, story and what was going to work. And I think there was a lot of it was lucky that a lot of the voices kind of fit with the design. And I don't know which came first, but you know, it just sort of worked out. I know Sean was later for the twins, and we had this sort of Danny-esque kind of shining character for the Barnabys. And I think he sort of found that voice through the design, which, you know, just paired up so well. They're probably my favorite characters in the film, just how well they work.
we're already 10 or 15 minutes over.
How are we?
Yeah, oh yeah, absolutely.
Sorry.
Well, that's good. That's a good thing, guys. That's a good thing. I mean, what else do people have to do, right? They're all at home.
Yeah. I'm happy. I'm very lonely. This is amazing. You know,
there's always, there's a lot of other questions. I'm going to ask you two more because one's really funny. How many screenings per year did you have? Which one was the worst screening?
We were trying to screen every 3 to 4 months, and the worst one was November of 2018, Kyle?
2018. Never forget.
That was our big LA debut. So we had a screening at Netflix, and it was the first time we'd sort of taken the movie out of our internal like little loop. And I think we had a 95-minute movie. We were trying to squeeze an 85-minute box, and it felt that way. So I look at the screenings as being, they're important. You got to learn how that movie's going. So those are painful ones, but that's how you learn.
You have to know what
slow motion stand-up.
What stuff to take seriously and what stuff is just going to work itself out, you know?
Yeah. But it's, I have a philosophy of like call and response. I don't know any other way to get smart about the movie. So I think Kyle can speak to like the crew side of things. Like we were showing the movie as much as possible, and we always were trying to make sure that everybody who was invested had context around the film. And so really the crew was the first audience, and then the crew's family. And then, you know, ultimately we started to screen out in the world and just hone that material down until the very end.
Oh, this will be the last question, guys. It's always the same question. Everybody I know enjoyed the movie. Me too. What's your next project? What are you working on next? And we'll either one of you go first.
Kyle.
You better go first because it's getting darker in your room.
I know. It's, yeah. I'm going to change here soon. Right now I'm kind of testing the waters a little bit. I'm doing a little bit of consulting, and I doing a little bit of work with Pearl Studio out of Portland right now. I've been on only for about 2 weeks, so it's early days on that for a feature they're doing with Netflix as well, which is exciting. But that's it for me.
And to use a farming metaphor, you put some seeds in the ground and you gotta, you know, wait till the rain comes and see what grows up. So I'm putting seeds in the ground. Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, I just doing that development cycle on a couple of projects, and you know, helping out a couple of filmmakers, and just trying to I think just do a little decompress, because this was literally it was Kyle, when did we do the last mix? It was like a week before the world shut down, right?
The 28th, February 28th.
Wow.
So it's insane. We just squeaked out.
I'm figuring this is going to get really great reviews. It's probably already started to get really great reviews, and lots of people
see it.
And you did a great job, guys. You really did a great job. And I want to thank the our attendees, everybody. Thank you for this very first time that we've done this. I think it worked out really well, and it streamed. We'll see what kind of comments we get, and then it'll go on our YouTube channel. In just a little while, and people will be able to watch it as well. I do appreciate you guys taking the time on Sunday.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you. Yeah, it was great.
Okay. Thank you all. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks. Thanks to the crew for making the movie, too.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay, Leslie, press the little magic button.